Welcome back to another episode of Mind, Body, Spirit. I'm Dr. Kate, and I'm very excited to announce today's guest. Her name is Marnie, and she is the woman behind the Wing Girl Method. Welcome.
Yes, I know. People always trip up over that because they're like, you're not a girl.
Yeah,
so stop
wing woman, wing girl.
Yeah. Not well, wing quite. Woman was taken at the time.
Oh, well, I like girl.
Yeah, I like girl too, exactly. Yeah.
Well, welcome to the show.
Thank you.
Thank you so much for being here.
Thank you. I'm fascinated by what you do, and I think it's a huge part of what I do as well. So.
And we were talking back behind the scenes about some of your health journey, and you have some very interesting.
Yeah.
I don't know how much you want to go into it.
But. I can go into a lot of it. I had a stroke when I was 20 with absolutely no indicators as to why that happened. And the truth is that I didn't realize why it possibly could happen until I stumbled upon functional medicine, Ayurvedic, Chinese medicine, alternative forms of medicine to realize why it happened to me.
That's incredible. And that, yeah, that's especially at such a young age. I mean, when things like that happen, it's usually difficult to find hard answers in the allopathic system.
And those systems were able to provide me with answers, which I don't know if that was helpful or not, but I think it definitely gave me some peace of mind to know that it was something that could be within my control.
Absolutely. So why don't we start by just talking about like who you are and what you do, if you could give us a brief intro and what Wing Girl Method is.
Well, so I coach men on how to understand women, and I actually have started working with women as well to help them understand men.
Okay. And how did that come about? Like how, I mean, you've
randomly,
been on this journey a while.
Yeah, I've been doing this for 14 years, but it randomly started at a singles mixer at a rabbi's house, like all, you know, matchmakers start their services at rabbi's houses. But I started it 14 years ago because I was there. I was there to meet other men. Was not interested in other men there, but I noticed that nobody was interacting. So I started grabbing men, and I would go up to women, and I would facilitate the conversation. And then after, I would leave them, and they would do fine. A couple of people were making out by the end, exchanging phone numbers. And then I said to my roommate that I wanted to be a wing girl. And he's like, I don't even know what that is, but there's no way that men want advice from women on how to be with women. I was like, I don't think you're right. I posted an ad on Craigslist, and I had over 75 guys respond by
Craigslist.
The next morning. Yes, oh my God, this was 14 years ago.
So what did Craigslist. That ad say?
It said, what better way to attract bees than with honey? Sit back and relax. I'll do the dirty work for you. Let me be your wing girl.
That is such a brilliant idea, first of all.
Thanks.
And did you get to inadvertently then just get to go out and kind of...
And then I got to explore Los Angeles.
Yeah,
it was amazing.
That is like brilliant. Like I have to take that in for a second. Like how that even would have worked. And very brave, I mean.
Thank you. Oh my God, I was 23 when I started this. And I remember when I did call home and said, like, I started a business. And they're like, you're an escort. That's horrible. I can't believe I sent you. And then I was like, maybe I have to tweak this a little bit. I did put in some guidelines so that it was more clear on what it was that I was doing.
Was there miscommunication in some of the...
I mean, I had some interest. It was on Craigslist.
Yeah.
So there were some people who totally got it. I didn't even get it at that point, to be honest. And some people who did not get it. And then I didn't end up working with those people. But shortly after I created this live service, I started to realize that many of the men that I was going out with to help them meet other women, they really just wanted answers from me. They didn't actually know how to do many of the things like approach, talk to women, flirt with them. So I started providing them with answers and guidance and tools and skills. And then I learned about online marketing. So then I put everything I taught them in person into programs and systems and packages so that they could learn on their own. Because I figured out that you're not really much of a man if you need a woman to do that. If you need somebody else to do that for you. You really feel like a man when you can
do
that yourself.
When you actually do it. And it's the same thing with like most practices. Like if you tell somebody what to be grateful for, then they don't...
They're not really grateful for it.
They have to use that muscle in their own mind to generate that muscle memory.
It doesn't mean anything to them.
Yeah. So you weren't just holding their hand, walking them up to girls. And I'm sure, I would imagine that some
now
men
I'm
have...
Now I'm virtually helping them.
Right. Like some men are struggling more with those initial skill set, and some men just haven't been able to meet anyone. And
there's a whole bunch of... they fall into three categories. Either they're divorced and they're like, I don't even know what an app is because I've been married for so long. Okay. How do I use this? Okay. And how do I date now? Mm-hmm. Or I don't know how to interact with women because I've always been focusing on my career. Or I just don't know little things and they're stumbling blocks for me. But most of the people that I work with, it all comes down to some sort of limiting belief about themselves, about what they deserve, and about what they can get.
Wow.
And so together, we help kind of wipe that slate clean, adjust a few things, and then as soon as really as soon as we eliminate those things for them, a lot of the other things fall into place much more easily.
And I think that hits home with, like, recently there's this I am enough movement for everyone, right? Both sexes, and it's
as it should be.
That hit pretty hard. On the internet. And
yeah. YouTube, well, the Me Too movement really hit my audience really hard. The guys that I work with are like the most amazing men in the entire world. And I have hundreds of thousands of guys who get my newsletters, watch my videos, listen to my podcast. Like, these are unbelievable men. They're not jerks or players or the guys that, you know, sort of just ghost on you. These are really, really good men.
Right.
And so when Me Too came out, these men got even more fearful to interact because they didn't want to be disrespectful. They were already afraid of being disrespectful. And now even more so, they were like, I don't want to do anything to upset a woman in any way. So it did really have like a horrible negative reaction from my audience.
It's interesting to hear you speak about it as a woman. And I think we all want to support women. But there's always two sides to every coin.
Yeah, because a lot of the times, and I don't want to like be down on women because I'm completely in support of people who went through any type of abuse or assault or any unwanted behavior, whether it's a glance or something that they didn't want, that somebody was not understanding to stop doing that behavior. And so a lot of thorough, clear explanation had to be spelled out for a lot of the men that I work with. I know you don't want to get
proprietary information.
Oh, but yeah, I'll tell you anything.
What did you tell these guys that were kind of, and what advice could you give to men out there who have been very intimidated by the Me Too movement and don't know how to interface with it?
It's explaining to them what these women are so upset about, what has happened to them, and then give them guidance on understanding signs and signals, use their voice to ask whether or not something they're doing is making somebody uncomfortable, or using their voice to ask whether or not they have consent to do something, whereas before they were looking for some sort of sign from a
signal.
Woman,
okay.
But when you're in your head, it's really difficult to read somebody else's body language. They, you know, when you've been hearing for so long, when a woman says no, it doesn't really mean no. So many people can misunderstand that. So spelling out exactly what that means, and really what we ended up giving as guidance on our podcast, when we had a full 3-hour discussion about this, was at the end of the day, you have to use your own moral compass about what you think is right and what you think is wrong. And that not being afraid of what's out there, still move forward respectfully and just ask if you're not sure if what you're doing is bothering somebody else.
That's amazing advice. Yeah. I'm trying to think, you know, if their moral compass is a little skewed.
If their moral compass is skewed, then they still have to ask, is this making you uncomfortable?
Okay.
And that's giving a woman permission to say yes, and to tell them on the other end that if you see a woman go, no, I'm okay, that they have to pay attention to what her body language is also expressing as well. And so if they see that, they have to learn to back off and say, you know what, I'm going to leave you alone for a little bit. The thing is that I can't control people who don't have a great moral compass. They're going to do what they want to do, but most of the men that we work with have overly fine-tuned moral compasses.
Okay, excellent. Wow. Yeah. So, and tell me more about your podcast. What type of stuff do you guys cover?
Everything about helping men understand women. I say understand women, but it's just more of giving them the female perspective. And so I have a man come onto the show every once in a while to provide expert skills and tools and guidance so that guys don't always hear from women talking about female stuff, because sometimes it can get a little bit too estrogeny for them. And then when we have women on the show, I really push them to give real answers about what they're saying, because like a lot of the times, many things that women say can be very confusing to men because they're talking from a different perspective than where the man is listening from. So I'm sort of that middle person that can help decode the woman and then help explain it to men so they can understand what she's trying to say.
Okay.
So we cover every topic. Mainly it's about attraction and flirtation and seduction and sexuality, confidence, how to approach, how to get out of the friend zone, how to talk to women. It's broken down. We've done over 300 episodes, so it's like we've covered everything.
Wow. Okay. So what do you see as some of the most challenging things in modern dating? Was that too broad?
No, yeah, I mean, it's a, everything can be challenging for everybody. The fact that there is so many things out there. There's a million apps, there's a million online things. People don't know how to interact in real life anymore.
Do you think the old model of like
going to a bar?
Well, no, I was just going to say getting married, being with one person forever. Like, do you think that that's changing? And
yeah,
I mean, and how do you see that going for the future?
I think it's going in a very nice direction, to be honest. I don't think that everybody should be coupling up forever. I think that you have to do what really feels right to you, which is why so many people are so gender fluid now, and there's so many different categories for gender. I don't know if I'm saying that correctly, but there's so many people who are just exploring and figuring out what they want to be and who they want to be, which I think is absolutely fantastic. And I love, like, my sister, who is 30 years old, and my other sister is so on her to hook up and marry and, like, just find that guy who she's going to marry and be with. She's scared for her.
Right.
But me, I'm like, this is absolutely amazing. Explore your life. Have fun. You're only 30 years old. Don't worry about any of those things on the back end. If you stumble into a relationship, you're out and about all the time. If you meet somebody that you do want to connect with in that way, that's wonderful. If you don't and you don't want to, then that's fine as well. I'm not for or against marriage. I'm for or against whatever is right for you.
I love that. That's great advice too, because there's a lot of pressure from just our old cultural paradigms, right?
Yeah.
Whereas nowadays, people just, I can relate.
Just everybody wants to put you into a box. I remember we were at my husband's home in Chicago, and one of his friends was at the time 42, and he was dating somebody that was 27.
Okay.
And one of their collective female friends, who was married to one of their friends, was so up in arms about how inappropriate that was and how could they ever have anything to talk about. They're now married with two children.
That doesn't seem like that crazy to me.
No, but if you are around that and you hear that and you hear that that's not right or that's not right or you're not allowed to feel this way or be attracted to somebody who's hot and young, which is like a weird thing to say, you're not allowed to be attracted to that, it just gets very confusing. And some people maybe do have that moral compass in a certain direction, could get heavily pressured by that information.
I could see that too.
Yeah. Instead of just going for what they want.
So should we revisit the stroke topic now?
Sure.
My mind keeps being like, stroke at 20. No. Can you tell me a little bit more? Because I know that you have a lot of content out there, and anyone who's interested can explore YouTube and like get tons of tips, right?
Oh, yeah.
But I'm very interested in knowing more about who you are and your story. So if we go back to how you think that, you know, intense health incident might have changed the trajectory of, like, I mean, I'm thinking about you being so fearless and taking risks, and I can't help but wonder if that comes with having like a near-death experience, right?
I don't know. To be honest, I know people say, oh, I almost died, and then I was like, oh my God, life is amazing. I didn't see me going through any of it. I didn't see that I had any issues going through it. If anything, it pulled me back a little bit. I was nervous because half of my body didn't work at the same speed of the other half of my body. I didn't feel as smart.
Like a mortality thing. Like you felt more.
Yeah, I was just like, I think I was more fearful, to be honest. I had worked before that to become more confident and get out of my shell.
Okay.
And then after that, I went into a shell. And then I moved to Los Angeles, and then I gave myself that fresh start. So when I moved to LA, I made a promise to myself to figure out what was going on, because I had stomach issues, which I think was very closely related to my stroke.
Okay.
So to figure out what was going on with my stomach and in my own dating life, it was to say yes to every opportunity that came my way. Anybody who asked me on a date, I would go on a date with them.
Just anybody. It didn't matter who they were.
I mean, if I walked by a homeless person, he asked me out, I'd go for coffee with him. Like anybody who asked me out, I would go out with them just to see what I liked, what I didn't like. And I just, because I was very limited to who was in my dating pool when I was in Toronto, where I'm from.
Okay.
So I just,
when you came here, you were like,
yeah, I just wanted to explore my opportunities. And same thing with inviting me to anything, whether it was for a date or not, I would go. I just wanted to see what was out there and have experiences that I wasn't exposed to in the past. I was in a new city.
Yeah.
And so for my health issues, like I quickly stumbled upon, after I went on a date with somebody who told me about acupuncture and Chinese medicine, I did find a Chinese doctor who like introduced me to all these herbs and then was talking to me and saying, I think you had your stroke because of emotional distress. And that was the first time I'd ever heard that, or that reason behind it was validated to me.
Okay.
Because when I was in Toronto, they said, oh, there's no way. There's no way that emotional stress could lead to a stroke. There's no way that I had disordered eating at the time. There's no way that disordered eating could lead to emotion, like to a stroke. And so finally hearing the validation that these things could be part of what had happened was like really validating.
Factors, yeah.
Oh yeah, for sure. I was eating tons of food that was sugar-free. So I had an immense amount of aspartame in my body.
And now it's affecting the gut.
Oh my God, yeah. So I had, so later on when I stumbled upon functional medicine and they are like, oh yeah, your gut is leaky. Like you have so much candida, you have it all over, like hearing those things and how it was impacting my body, my mind, my mood, everything. And then learning about how to, I don't know if it was eliminate it, but to clear it up a little bit, that completely, it changed my life. It changed my mood, it changed my skin, it changed my stomach, it changed my sex drive, it changed my energy levels, it changed my brain. So that was a huge thing.
That is, yeah, that is something I see all the time.
And, oh, I'm sure, yeah.
And especially at that young age where you're in that preventative zone, you can really affect the trajectory of the rest of your life
yeah.
and the health of your body. But to be at the level you're at, it's great that you had that intervention. And how are you doing now?
I'm pretty good. Well, I will say though, I did start to slip back to some of my old eating habits because I have heard that if you eliminate things for too long, you can develop more allergies and you can develop more intolerances. So I started to introduce some things back into my diet and then I introduced them a little bit too much.
Okay.
And so now it's having some of those negative effects again. But I know how to comment now.
Your own intuition is guiding you
yeah.
through. And yeah, sometimes
when... No, it's tough to give up the things that I've...
Right. It's both. It's like with the maturity of like knowing your body comes the longer habit.
Yeah.
Right.
Yeah, absolutely.
Well, I think it's so incredible just thinking about you being like this young woman going out saying yes to everyone. Just where does that fearlessness come from? Was that something that was ingrained in you from your parents or is it astrological or?
Oh God, I have absolutely no idea. My okay. mom is here with me now. Maybe you can ask her.
Okay.
But I don't know. I didn't ever like the word no when I was younger. So I think that's something that's always.
Did you get in trouble for that as a child?
I don't know if I got in trouble for it. I think my parents have always been really supportive of everything that I wanted to do. I had to fight for it a
okay.
lot. I think when you're the eldest child, you have to fight for a lot more in the very beginning. So I think that's why the older child is more persistent and driven. Maybe I'm incorrect with that. But yeah, they've always been really supportive of everything that I've done. And they've never really restricted me. They may have challenged me in the beginning if I ever wanted to do something. But then that helps me figure out why I wanted to do it. So same thing when my roommate said to me, yeah, guys aren't going to want to do this. If he had said, yeah, that's a great idea, I would have laughed about it for 10 minutes and then I wouldn't have done it. But because he challenged it, I was like, okay, let's see if this works.
Okay.
So yeah. I think that that maybe saying no in the very beginning has been beneficial for me.
I can relate to that for sure. Like the concept of when you're told that you can't do something, it kind of makes you want to prove that you can.
Yeah, you're like, oh, well, let's figure out why I should be able to do this.
But I have no idea where that comes from
yeah.
psychologically.
Not astrologically?
Astrologically, I could probably...
Well, I'm a Sagittarius.
Theorize. Well, they're supposed yeah. to be very adventurous, right?
What are you?
Fearless. Oh, Libra.
Oh, so you're tough too.
Well, I don't know. You have to look at the other positions, right?
Like oh God, I don't know about that stuff, but I do know that many of my boyfriends have been Libras and very strong.
Were they? Okay. Yeah. My experience with Libra men, they're usually like more delicate and
oh,
pretty.
Oh, really?
Yeah.
Oh, no.
Like little charming social butterfly... Well dressed.
Well, that too.
Yeah.
But now I'm with a Leo.
Oh, nice.
So I have the ultimate in stubbornness.
That's
which is
husband?
Great for me okay. because I like challenges.
Yes.
Mm-hmm.
So what has the role of challenge been in your life as far as taking on new things, like as you've evolved into the woman
oh,
you are
God,
now?
My challenges have been adjusting my lifestyle and my work life.
Okay.
That's been the most challenging. But I don't know when you ask challenges.
No, that's great.
Yeah.
Let's talk about that. So
yeah.
that's something we all, women who want a career and want a family and a good relationship with their partner.
I don't know how Sheryl Sandberg does it. I've been leaning in a lot, but I'm freaking tired. I don't know how she does it. I think some women can get up earlier in the morning and can either get better sleep in those condensed 6 hours. I don't sleep as well, and I can't function as well. Maybe if I was doing more and maybe forcing myself to do more, maybe I would be better with a lot of things. But I do find that the challenge now is that I slip into a place where I am more down on myself because I can't do more. But I have to keep talking myself out of that and saying, you're doing pretty freaking well.
I think you are.
Yeah.
Yeah. There is that balance of like self-forgiveness and also just realizing, like being grateful for what you have done. I mean, you've done so
yeah.
much.
Well, you know what? Somebody was, thank you for saying that. Somebody was on my podcast the other day and they were giving tips about approach anxiety, but also about like lower self-confidence. And one of the things that they said was, if you ever are in a moment of doubt about yourself, just reframe what you've said about yourself, but do it from a third party position so that you can have the bird's eye view. So if you're like, oh, you're not doing enough, and then you say, she's not doing enough, or Marnie's not doing enough, then you sort of question it because you're like, wait, why am I doing all this?
Then you
want to
defend yourself. You're like, no, she's doing a lot.
Yeah, you're like, shut your mouth. Like, don't say that. But it's true. Yeah. It's like when you have the bird's eye view, you can be more realistic. But when you're in this space where you're focused on yourself and you're putting yourself down constantly, you can manifest your way all the way up to like saying that you're the worst person in the entire world when you're absolutely a wonderful person. There's no limits for it.
That is, I'm taking it in. That's profound.
Oh, thanks.
Well, we'll have to check out that podcast episode,
too. Yeah, it was really good.
But, well, anyways, thank you so much, Marnie, for coming. Where can people find you to keep up with Wing Girl Method?
Yes.
And everything else you're doing, which is evolving, too.
Well, they can go to thewinggirlmethod.com.
Okay.
If there are women who are watching, they can go to thatsnothowmenwork.com.
Okay.
So the first program that I ever created for women was based on the information that I've learned about
men.
Because I get to hear everything they say, and I found out a lot of things about men that I didn't know about men.
Awesome.
So thatsnothowmenwork.com.
Okay. Well, I'm excited to check out those links. And thank you everyone for tuning in. This has been another episode of Mind, Body, Spirit. I'm Dr. Kate.
I'm Marnie.
And we'll see you next time. Bye.